Rule 41, boarding. A boarding penalty shall be imposed on any player who checks or pushes a defenseless opponent in such a manner that causes the opponent to hit or impact the boards violently or dangerously.
They're trying to get him a little bit from the side, but he winds up driving his head right into the wall.
The severity of the penalty, based upon the impact with the boards, shall be at the discretion of the referee.
Oof, crunching hit along the boards.
There is an enormous amount of judgment involved in the application of this rule by the referees. The onus is on the player applying the check to ensure his opponent is not in a defenseless position. And if so, he must avoid or minimize contact. The referee, at his discretion, may assess a minor penalty or major penalty for boarding. When a major penalty is assessed under this rule for a foul resulting in an injury to the face or head of an opponent, a game misconduct shall be imposed. Rule 42, charging. A charging penalty shall be imposed on a player who skates, jumps into, or charges an opponent in any manner.
That's a penalty. He jumped up and nailed the Capitals defender.
Charging shall mean the actions of a player who, as a result of distance traveled, shall violently check an opponent in any manner. A charge may be the result of a check into the boards, into the goal frame, or in open ice. The referee, at his discretion, may assess a minor penalty or major penalty for charging. When a major penalty is imposed under this rule for a foul resulting in an injury to the face or head of an opponent, a game misconduct shall be imposed. Rule 43, checking from behind. A check from behind is a check delivered on a player who is not aware of the impending hit, therefore unable to protect or defend himself, and contact is made on the back part of the body.
Nesterov could see his number 11 and follow through on it.
The referee cannot assess a minor penalty for checking from behind. Only a major penalty can be assessed. When a major penalty is imposed for checking from behind, a game misconduct shall be imposed. Rule 44, clipping. Clipping is the act of throwing the body across or below the knees of an opponent from any direction.
Handling over the line. Whoa,
yeah.
A poke check behind, but an upended Pearson. That's dangerous.
A player may not deliver a check in a clipping manner, nor lower his own body position to deliver a check on or below an opponent's knees. An illegal low hit is a check that is delivered by a player who may or may not have both skates on the ice, with his sole intent to check the opponent in the area of his knees. The referee, at his discretion, may assess a minor penalty or major penalty for clipping. A game misconduct penalty must be assessed anytime a major penalty is applied for injuring an opponent by clipping.
Kulikov is gone. It's a 5-minute major.
Rule 45, elbowing. Elbowing shall mean the use of an extended elbow in a manner that may or may not cause injury.
Oh, elbow right to the head by Dreisaitl.
The referee, at his discretion, may assess a minor penalty or major penalty for elbowing. When a major penalty is assessed under this rule for a foul resulting in an injury to the face or head of an opponent, a game misconduct shall be imposed. Rule 46, fighting. A fight shall be deemed to have occurred when at least one player punches or attempts to punch an opponent repeatedly, or when two players wrestle in such a manner as to make it difficult for the linesman to intervene and separate the combatants. The referees are provided very wide latitude in the penalties with which they may impose under this rule. This is done intentionally to enable them to differentiate between the obvious degrees of responsibility of the participants either for starting the fight or persisting in continuing the fight. An instigator of an altercation shall be a player who by his actions or demeanor demonstrates any or some of the following criteria: distance traveled, gloves off first, first punch thrown, menacing attitude or posture, verbal instigation or threats, conduct in retaliation to a prior incident or obvious retribution for a previous incident in the game or season. No player may remove his helmet prior to engaging in a fight. If he should do so, he shall be assessed a 2-minute minor penalty for unsportsmanlike conduct. Helmets that come off in the course of and resulting from the altercation will not result in a penalty to either player. A player who engages in a fight and whose jersey is not properly tied down and who loses his jersey in that altercation shall receive a game misconduct penalty.
And there's the sweater. Comes right off of Versteeg, so not tied down.
The referee cannot assess a minor penalty for fighting. Only a major penalty can be assessed. A match penalty, however, shall be assessed to a player who punches an unsuspecting or unwilling opponent and causes an injury. If any player wearing tape or any other material on his hands, below the wrist, who cuts or injures an opponent during an altercation, will receive a match penalty in addition to any other penalties imposed, including for fighting under this rule. Rule 47, headbutting. The act of headbutting involves a player making intentional contact or attempting to make contact with an opponent by leading with his head and or helmet. The referee cannot assess a minor penalty for headbutting. Only a double minor penalty or major penalty can be assessed. When a major penalty is imposed for headbutting, a game misconduct shall be imposed. Rule 48, illegal check to the head. A hit resulting in contact with an opponent's head, where the head was the main point of contact, and such contact to the head was avoidable, is not permitted.
And a penalty has been called on Blake.
The one thing they look at is that propelling up high, and he clearly does that there.
In determining whether contact with an opponent's head was avoidable, the circumstances of the hit, including the following, shall be considered. 1. Whether the player attempted to hit squarely through the opponent's body, and the head was not picked as a result of poor timing, poor angle of approach, or unnecessary extension of the body upward or outward. 2. Whether the opponent put himself in a vulnerable position by assuming a posture that made head contact on an otherwise full body check unavoidable. 3. Whether the opponent materially changed the position of his body or head immediately prior to or simultaneously with the hit in a way that significantly contributed to the head contact. The referee can only assess a minor penalty for illegal check to the head. There is no major penalty for illegal check to the head. However, a match penalty can be assessed if the referee deems a player deliberately attempts to or deliberately injures an opponent. Rule 49, kicking. The action of a player deliberately using his skate with a kicking motion to contact an opponent. A match penalty shall be imposed on any player who kicks or attempts to kick another player. The referee can only assess a match penalty for kicking, whether or not an injury occurs. No minor penalty or major penalty can be assessed under the kicking rule. Rule 50, kneeing. Kneeing is the act of a player leading with his knee and in some cases extending his leg outwards to make contact with his opponent.
Now watch three, realizes he's going to be beat, so he sticks out his leg.
The referee, at his discretion, may assess a minor penalty or major penalty for kneeing.
Hey boy, you lead with that knee. That looks bad, doesn't it? Right into the left thigh of Devin Shore.
When a major penalty is imposed for kneeing, a game misconduct shall be imposed. Rule 51, roughing. Roughing is a punching or slamming motion with or without the glove on the hand, normally directed at the head or face of an opponent, or if a player intentionally removes an opponent's helmet during play.
Calvert and Subban going at it there, and he knocks the helmet off of Calvert.
The referee can only assess a minor penalty for roughing. There is no major penalty or game misconduct for roughing. Rule 52, slew footing. Slew footing is the act of a player using his leg or foot to knock or kick an opponent's feet from under him, or pushes an opponent's upper body backward with an arm or elbow, and at the same time, with a forward motion of his leg, knocks or kicks the opponent's feet from under him, causing him to fall violently to the ice.
Right leg of Marchand behind the leg. That's a sloop foot.
Any player who is guilty of sloop footing shall be assessed a match penalty. There is no minor penalty or major penalty for sloop footing. Rule 53, throwing equipment. A player shall not throw a stick or any other object in any zone. A player who has lost or broken his stick may only receive a stick at his own player's bench or be handed one from a teammate on the ice.
You must hand the stick to the player. You cannot toss it in any fashion. There's the captain throwing it right out to Wilson. A definite penalty. The coach.
When a defending player shoots or throws a stick or any other object at the puck or the puck carrier in the defending zone, but does not interfere in any manner with the puck or puck carrier, a minor penalty shall be assessed. If a member of the defending team throws or shoots any part of a stick or any other object which does interfere with the puck or puck carrier, a penalty shot shall be awarded.
You cannot shoot a piece of equipment at another player to dislodge the puck.
When a player discards the broken portion of a stick or some other object by tossing it or shooting it to the side of the ice in such a way as will not interfere with play or opposing player, no penalty will be imposed. A misconduct penalty shall be imposed on a player who unintentionally or accidentally throws his stick or any part thereof, or any other object or piece of equipment outside the playing area.
The stick snaps here, he's frustrated, and then walks right up into the crowd.
If the offense is committed intentionally, a game misconduct penalty shall be assessed to the offending player. If, when the opposing goalkeeper has been removed, a member of the defending team throws or shoots any part of a stick or any other object at the puck or puck carrier in the neutral or his own defending zone, thereby preventing the puck carrier from having a clear shot on an open net, a goal shall be awarded to the attacking side.
A thrown stick with an empty net results in an automatic goal.
Rule 54, holding. Holding is any action by a player that restrains or impedes the progress of an opposing player, whether or not he is in possession of the puck.
Left hand free, Aspen will go to the box.
A minor penalty shall be imposed on a player who holds an opponent by using his hands, arms, or legs. A player is permitted to use his arm in a strength move by blocking his opponent, provided he has body position and is not using his hands in a holding manner. A player is not permitted to hold an opponent's stick. A minor penalty shall be assessed to a player who holds an opponent's stick, assessed and announced as holding the stick. A player is permitted to protect himself by defending against an opponent's stick. He must immediately release the stick and allow the player to resume normal play. Rule 55, hooking. Hooking is the act of using the stick in a manner that enables a player to restrain an opponent. A minor penalty shall be imposed on a player who impedes the progress of an opponent by hooking with his stick.
Tyler Ennis with a hook on Slater Cuckoo.
When a player is checking another in such a way that there is only stick-to-stick contact, such action is not to be penalized as hooking. A major penalty shall be imposed on any player who injures an opponent by hooking. When a major penalty has been assessed for hooking as a result of an injury to an opponent, a game misconduct penalty must also be assessed. Rule 56, interference. A strict standard on acts of interference must be adhered to in all areas of the rink. A minor penalty shall be imposed on a player who interferes with or impedes the progress of an opponent who is not in possession of the puck.
There's a penalty coming up here. This is interference.
This can include, but is not limited to, face-off or pick plays. A minor penalty shall be imposed on a player who restrains an opponent who is attempting to forecheck.
Hit by Bennett and a penalty for interference.
And you see Bennett just getting his stick in there. All he has to do is brush him rather than put the stick into the hip.
A minor penalty shall be imposed on any player who deliberately checks an opponent, including the goalkeeper, who is not in possession of the puck.
Ekman Larson chasing after the loose puck. The puck was a long way gone.
A minor penalty shall be imposed on a player who deliberately knocks a stick out of an opponent's hand, or who prevents a player who has dropped his stick or any other piece of equipment from regaining possession of it. A minor penalty shall be imposed on any player on the player's bench or penalty bench who, by means of his stick or his body, interferes with the movements of the puck or any opponent on the ice during the progress of the play.
You can see Carrier swatted the puck before he's completely on the ice, which draws the interference call.
In addition, should a player about to come onto the ice play the puck while one or both skates are still on the player's or penalty bench, a minor penalty for interference shall be assessed. The referee, at his discretion, may assess a major penalty based on the degree of violence to a player guilty of interfering with an opponent.
The last thing that Pro is expecting is to get hit because it's so late and he's not even looking in the right direction.
When a major penalty is imposed under this rule for a foul resulting in an injury of an opponent, a game misconduct shall be imposed. Rule 57, tripping. A player shall not place the stick, knee, foot, arm, hand, or elbow in such a manner that causes his opponent to trip or fall.
Yeah, Tony D'Angelo, with one hand on the stick, tried to reach through the legs and play the puck and instead got the skates.
A minor penalty shall be imposed on any player who shall place his stick or any portion of his body in such a manner that it shall cause his opponent to trip and fall. If, in the opinion of the referee, a player leaves his feet and makes contact with the puck first and subsequently trips his opponent in doing so, a minor penalty for tripping shall be assessed.
Myers makes contact with the puck that used to nullify the trip, but it's not that way anymore.
Rule 57, tripping. If, in the opinion of the referee, a player leaves his feet and makes contact with the puck first and subsequently trips his opponent in doing so, a minor penalty for tripping shall be assessed.
Myers makes contact with the puck that used to nullify the trip, but it's not that way anymore.
Rule 58, butt ending. The action whereby a player uses the shaft of the stick above the upper hand to check an opposing player in any manner, or jabs or attempts to jab an opposing player with this part of the stick. There is no minor penalty for butt ending. A double minor penalty will be imposed on a player who attempts to butt end an opponent, and a major penalty shall be imposed on a player who butt-ends an opponent.
And then watch 17, the butt-end right there, right into the stomach.
When a major penalty is imposed for butt-ending, a game misconduct shall be imposed. Rule 59, cross-checking. The action of using the shaft of the stick between the two hands to forcefully check an opponent.
McAvoy gets cross-checked.
The referee, at his discretion, based on the severity of the contact, may assess a minor penalty or major penalty for cross-checking. When a major penalty is imposed under this rule, an automatic game misconduct shall be imposed. Rule 60, high sticking. A high stick is one which is carried above the height of the opponent's shoulders. Players must be in control and responsible for their stick. Any contact made by a stick on an opponent above the shoulders is prohibited, and a minor penalty shall be imposed.
McCabe just looks for the puck, but he gets his stick up, and he gets Andre.
However, a player is permitted accidental contact on an opponent if the act is committed as a normal wind-up or follow-through of a shooting motion.
This is a follow-through play on a pass.
A wild swing at a bouncing puck would not be considered a normal wind-up or follow-through, and any contact to an opponent above the height of the shoulders shall be penalized accordingly.
Penalty here against the Capitals.
When a player carries or holds any part of his stick above the shoulders and makes contact with his opponent's neck, face, or head so that injury results, the referee may assess a double minor penalty. Rule 60, high sticking. A high stick is one which is carried above the height of the opponent's shoulders. Any contact made by a stick on an opponent above the shoulders is prohibited. However, a player is permitted accidental contact on an opponent if the act is committed as a normal wind-up or follow-through of a shooting motion.
This is a follow-through play on a pass.
A wild swing at a bouncing puck would not be considered a normal wind-up or follow-through, and any contact to an opponent above the height of the shoulders shall be penalized accordingly.
Penalty here against the Capitals.
Rule 61, slashing. Slashing is the act of a player swinging his stick at an opponent. Non-aggressive stick contact to the pant or front of the shin pads should not be penalized as slashing. Any forceful or powerful chop with the stick on an opponent's body, the opponent's stick, or on or near the opponent's hands that, in the judgment of the referee, is not an attempt to play the puck, shall be penalized as slashing.
Oh, right on the left hand.
The referee, at his discretion, based on the severity of the contact, may assess a minor penalty or major penalty for slashing. When injury occurs, a major penalty must be assessed under this rule.
Like, that is so careless right there. You could really hurt somebody.
When a major penalty is imposed under this rule, a game misconduct shall also be imposed. Rule 62, spearing. Spearing shall mean stabbing an opponent with the point of the stick blade, whether contact is made or not.
And there's right there, the spear.
That's a spear.
There is no minor penalty for spearing. Only a double minor penalty or major penalty can be called for spearing. Whenever a major penalty is assessed for spearing, a game misconduct penalty must also be imposed. Rule 63, delaying the game. A player or a team may be penalized when, in the opinion of the referee, they are delaying the game in any manner.
And now the whistle sounds.
He might get a penalty.
And Giordano is going to get a penalty here.
Yeah.
A minor penalty shall be imposed on any player, including the goalkeeper, who holds, freezes, or plays the puck with his stick, skates, or body in such a manner as to deliberately cause a stoppage of play. A minor penalty for delay of game shall be imposed on any player that shoots or bats using his hand or his stick the puck directly out of the playing surface from his defending zone. The determining factor shall be the position of the puck when it was shot or batted by the offending player.
Oh, might be a penalty. That's going to be a penalty.
If contact with the puck occurs while the puck is inside the defending zone and subsequently goes out of play, the minor penalty shall be assessed.
Take a look here. It's where the puck is, not where your skates are. Hence, they get it right.
A minor penalty shall be imposed on any player who delays the game by deliberately displacing a goalpost from its normal position.
The goal comes off the mooring, and LA's going to get penalized.
If the minor penalty assessed to a player for deliberately displacing his own goalpost cannot be served in its entirety within the regular playing time of the game or at any time in overtime, a penalty shot shall be awarded against the offending team. When the goalpost has been displaced deliberately by the defending team, when their goalkeeper has been removed for an extra attacker, the referee shall award a goal to the attacking team. If a goalkeeper comes out of his crease to cut down the angle on a shot, and after making the save, covers the puck, this shall be legal. If the goalkeeper races out of his crease in an attempt to beat the attacking player to the puck, and instead of playing the puck, jumps on the puck, causing a stoppage of play, this shall be a minor penalty for delay of game.
Will they get a penalty call here? I think they will.
Delay of game.
A goalkeeper shall not play the puck outside of the designated area behind the net.
Played outside, yeah, there's going to be a penalty.
Should the goalkeeper play the puck outside of the designated area behind the goal line, a minor penalty for delay of game shall be imposed.
But right here doesn't get any more obvious than that. Referees are right on top of that.
The determining factor shall be the position of the puck. The minor penalty will not be assessed when a goalkeeper plays the puck while maintaining skate contact with his goal crease. Rule 64, embellishment. Any player who blatantly embellishes a fall or a reaction, or who feigns an injury, shall be penalized with a minor penalty under this rule.
Never even hit his face, put his head back.
A goalkeeper who deliberately initiates contact with an attacking player, other than to establish position in the crease, or who otherwise acts to create the appearance of other than incidental contact, is subject to the assessment of a minor penalty for embellishment. Rule 67, handling puck. A player shall be permitted to catch the puck out of the air, but must immediately place it or knock it down to the ice. If he catches it and skates with it, either to avoid a check or to gain a territorial advantage over his opponent, a minor penalty shall be assessed for closing his hand on the puck.
Pressure right here, knocks it down, but holds on to it a little bit too long.
Anytime a player places his hand over the puck while it is on the ice in order to conceal it, a minor penalty shall be assessed for closing his hand on the puck.
And it's clearly a penalty. As you can see, he puts his hand right on the puck.
When this is done in his team's goal crease area, a penalty shot shall be assessed or a goal awarded if the goaltender was removed for an extra attacker. Rule 69, goalie interference.
Puck to goalie!
Like many rules, goalie interference is a judgment call made by an official. Goalie interference is not black and white, and no two plays are the same. Rule 69 states, an attacking player's position, whether inside or outside the crease, should not, by itself, determine whether a goal should be allowed or disallowed. The overriding rationale of this rule is that a goalkeeper should have the ability to move freely within his goal crease without being hindered by the actions of an attacking player. Can a goal be scored with an attacking player inside the crease?
And scores! What a great effort!
Yes. In this example, Josh Anderson is in the blue paint when the goal is scored, but the official judged that the goalkeeper was not hindered by his actions. The goal was allowed. However, goals will be disallowed if an official deems the attacking player, either by his positioning or contact, impairs the goalkeeper's ability to do his job. When we look at contact with the goalie, there are two keys. First, where did the contact occur? In the blue or in the white? Second, was the contact incidental or deliberate? Let's start with the blue or inside the crease. If the official judges the attacker initiates contact with the goalkeeper, incidental or otherwise, and a goal is scored, the goal will be disallowed.
Now the goal is being waved off by O'Halloran.
In this example, the official deems Matthew Joseph initiates contact with Ilya Samsonov inside the blue. The goal is disallowed. Similarly, if the official judges the goalkeeper initiates contact with the attacker, and as a result it affects the goalkeeper's ability to defend his goal, the goal will also be disallowed. In this example, Matt Murray, while trying to make a save, initiates contact with Sven Andraghetto inside the blue. This goal is also disallowed.
Get some help from Nylander, who's got it right in front of the net. Chance to score!
A goal may be allowed when there is contact in the blue if the official deems an attacking player makes incidental contact with the goalkeeper while both are attempting to play a loose puck at the time a goal is scored. In this example, the official deems Austin Matthews and Jonathan Bernier are attempting to play a loose puck when contact is made. The goal should be allowed. A goal will be disallowed, however, if an official judges the attacker pushes the goalkeeper while attempting to play a loose puck and prevents the goalkeeper from doing his job.
And it's in the net, but it's wiped out.
In this example, Corey Perry pushes Connor Hellebuck with his stick, and as a result, the puck crosses the goal line. The goal is disallowed. Now let's go to the white. A goalkeeper is not fair game just because he is outside his goal crease. However, an official may allow incidental contact when the goalkeeper is in the act of playing the puck outside the crease. In this example, Gabriel Landeskog makes contact with Ryan Miller in the white. This is deemed to be incidental contact. Therefore, the goal was allowed. However, if contact in the white is deemed to be deliberate, the goal will be disallowed.
Sergei Bobrovsky is complaining.
In this example, Cam Atkinson makes contact with Sergei Bobrovsky's glove in the white. It is deemed to be deliberate contact. Therefore, the goal was disallowed. When determining where contact occurred, it's important to remember the dimensions of the crease, which extends vertically 4 feet to the top of the goal. Just because an attacker's feet are in the white doesn't mean there can't be contact in the blue. Here, James Van Riemsdyk's skates are in the white when he makes incidental contact with Keith Kincaid. However, the official judges this contact to be in the blue, and the goal is disallowed. The official must also take into consideration if the attacking player or defending player is pushed into the goalkeeper. If the official judges that the attacking player has been shoved by a defending player into the goalkeeper, such contact will not be deemed initiated by the attacker.
Miller pushes, I believe that was Timo Meier, into Marc-Andre Fleury.
Here, Colin Miller pushes Timo Meier into Marc-Andre Fleury prior to the goal being scored. The official deems Meier did not initiate contact with Fleury, and the goal was allowed. Similarly, if the official judges that the defending player has been shoved by an attacking player into the goalkeeper, such contact will be deemed initiated by the attacker.
Right away, the officials say no goal.
In this example, Sam Bennett shoves Eric Johnson into Philip Grubauer prior to the goal being scored. The official deems the contact was initiated by the attacker. No goal. Finally, incidental contact may be allowed in the blue or the white, provided play continues and the goalkeeper is allowed to reset his position.
He's knocked down here. Does he have an opportunity to get up?
In this example, Jordan Eberle makes incidental contact with Frederick Anderson. The official judges that Anderson has time to reset before Anthony Beauvillier scores. The goal is allowed.
No penalty, no goal, incidental contact outside.
With regards to penalties involving goalie interference, it is at the referee's discretion to impose a penalty when an attacking player initiates contact with the goalie, whether or not a goal is scored. In this example, Miles Wood initiates contact with Tuukka Rask inside the crease. Wood is given a goalie interference penalty.
And they're going to protect goaltenders at all costs, so Miles Wood has to be careful and understand where he is in that net.
Here, Blake Como initiates contact with Curtis McElhenney as the puck enters the net.
And they wipe it out immediately!
The referee waves off the goal and, due to the nature of the contact, also chooses to impose a goalie interference penalty to Como.
He bumped you here, but I had him in the white. I'm on the other side. It's hard to see, but it looked like it was a bit outside your blue right there. Good?
To recap, the keys to goalie interference are, first, where did the contact occur? In the blue or in the white? Second, was the contact incidental or deliberate. Contact in the blue, if deemed deliberate, should result in no goal. Incidental contact in the blue can be permitted if the contact doesn't impair the goalie's ability to do his job. For example, when a goalkeeper has time to reset after incidental contact, or when an attacker and goalkeeper make incidental contact attempting to play a loose puck. Contact in the white must be deemed deliberate for a goal to be disallowed. If the official judges the contact to be incidental, the goal may stand. As mentioned before, goals may be allowed if the official deems the attacking player has been pushed into the goalkeeper, provided the attacker has made a reasonable effort to avoid such contact. It is at the referee's discretion to impose a penalty when an attacking player initiates contact with the goalie, whether or not a goal is scored. We hope this video has provided some clarity with regards to Rule 69, Goalie Interference. Rule 69, Goalie Interference. When we look at contact with the goalie, there are two keys. First, where did the contact occur? In the blue or in the white? Second, was the contact incidental or deliberate? Let's start with the blue or inside the crease. If the official judges the attacker initiates contact with the goalkeeper, incidental or otherwise, and a goal is scored, the goal will be disallowed.
Now the goal is being waved off by O'Halloran.
In this example, the official deems Matthew Joseph initiates contact with Ilya Samsonov inside the blue. The goal is disallowed. Similarly, if the official judges the goalkeeper initiates contact with the attacker, and as a result, it affects the goalkeeper's ability to defend his goal, the goal will also be disallowed. In this example, Matt Murray, while trying to make a save, initiates contact with Sven Andraghetto inside the blue. This goal is also disallowed.
Gets some help from Nylander, who's got it right in front of the net. Chance is gone!
A goal may be allowed when there is contact in the blue if the official deems an attacking player makes incidental contact with the goalkeeper while both are attempting to play a loose puck at the time a goal is scored. In this example, the official deems Austin Matthews and Jonathan Bernier are attempting to play a loose puck when contact is made. The goal should be allowed. A goal will be disallowed, however, if an official judges the attacker pushes the goalkeeper while attempting to play a loose puck and prevents the goalkeeper from doing his job.
And it's in the net, but it's wiped out.
In this example, Corey Perry pushes Connor Hellebuck with his stick, and as a result, the puck crosses the goal line. The goal is disallowed. Now let's go to the white. A goalkeeper is not fair game just because he is outside his goal crease. However, an official may allow incidental contact when the goalkeeper is in the act of playing the puck outside the crease. In this example, Gabriel Landeskog makes contact with Ryan Miller in the white. This is deemed to be incidental contact. Therefore, the goal was allowed. However, if contact in the white is deemed to be deliberate, the goal will be disallowed.
Sergei Bobrovsky is complaining.
In this example, Cam Atkinson makes contact with Sergei Bobrovsky's glove in the white. It is deemed to be deliberate contact. Therefore, the goal was disallowed. When determining where contact occurred, it's important to remember the dimensions of the crease, which extends vertically 4 feet to the top of the goal. Just because an attacker's feet are in the white doesn't mean there can't be contact in the blue. Here, James Van Riemsdyk's skates are in the white when he makes incidental contact with Keith Kincaid. However, the official judges this contact to be in the blue, and the goal is disallowed. Thank you. Rule 74, too many men on the ice. Players may be changed at any time during the play from the player's bench, provided that the player or players leaving the ice shall be within 5 feet of his player's bench and out of the play before the change is made. At the discretion of the on-ice officials, should a substituting player come onto the ice before his teammate is within the 5-foot limit of the player's bench, and therefore clearly causing his team to have too many players on the ice, then a bench minor penalty may be assessed.
And the Flyers will get a power play with 21.5 seconds remaining.
Too many men on the ice for the Boston Bruins, and it was Bergeron that was heading off the ice. Still a considerable length to get to his bench.
If, in the course of making a substitution, either the player entering the game or the player retiring from the ice surface plays the puck with his stick, skates, or hands, or who checks or makes any physical contact with an opposing player, then the infraction of too many men on the ice will be called. If, however, in the course of a substitution, either the player entering the play or the player retiring is struck by the puck accidentally, no penalty will be called.
Stastny was kind of going to the bench. The puck hit him.
Yeah, you have to get involved in the play, right? He was just trying to get off the ice.
Rule 76, face-off violation. Players facing off are prohibited from batting the puck with their hand in an attempt to win the face-off.
And that's going to be a penalty on Tyson Jost.
Any attempt by either center to win the face-off by batting the puck with their hand shall result in a minor penalty for delay of game, face-off violation. The two players involved in the face-off cannot play the puck with their hand until a third player from either team has at least touched the puck. Rule 79, hand pass. A player shall be permitted to stop or bat a puck in the air with his open hand or push it along the ice with his hand unless, in the opinion of the officials, he has directed the puck to a teammate or has allowed his team to gain an advantage. In this example, Philippe Myers bats the puck in the offensive zone, and it is played by Derek Brandt. Whistle is blown for a hand pass. Here, Brett Kulak bats the puck forward in the neutral zone, and it is picked up by Max Domi, thus giving his team an advantage. The whistle is blown for a hand pass. Play will not be stopped, however, for any hand pass by players in their own defending zone. In this example, Andy Green bats the puck forward in his defending zone, and it is picked up by Jordan Eberle. This play is legal. The location of the puck when contacted by either the player making the hand pass or the player receiving the hand pass shall determine the zone it is in.
Hand pass called with 7:08 to go here.
In this example, Frédéric Gauthier directs the puck with his glove from his defensive zone. However, it is received by a teammate in the offensive zone. Because the hand pass is received in the offensive zone, the whistle is blown for a hand pass. If a hand pass is committed, but the puck does not subsequently come in possession and control of the offending team, play will not be stopped. In this example, Logan Couture bats the puck forward in the offensive zone. It is not subsequently played by a teammate, though, as Jay Bomeister plays the puck. The hand pass is negated. Rule 80, high-sticking the puck. Batting the puck above the normal height of the shoulders with a stick is prohibited.
High stick puck outside.
When a puck is struck with a high stick and subsequently comes into the possession and control of a player from the offending team, either directly or deflected off any player or official, there shall be a whistle. In this example, Carl Hagelin bats the puck above the normal height of the shoulders and subsequently plays it. The whistle is blown for a high stick. Here, Brent Burns swings his stick over his head and makes contact with the puck. His teammate subsequently plays the puck. The whistle is blown for a high stick. When a puck has been contacted by a high stick, the play shall be permitted to continue if the puck is subsequently played by an opponent.
And play continues on as Ekman Larson took it.
In this example, Matt Nieto deflects the puck with a high stick. Both linesmen signal high stick. It is subsequently played by a player on the Coyotes, though, and play is permitted to continue. However, in this example, Tyler Johnson high-sticks the puck. It deflects off Torrey Krug before Alex Killorn shoots the puck into the net.
Waved off as it goes across the line, a high stick, knocked the puck out of the air into the net.
The goal is disallowed because the whistle went for a high-sticked puck.
Does Krug get any kind of control? No, it just bounces off him right into the slot.
Although the puck deflects off Krug, he does not play the puck. Therefore, the high-sticked puck is not negated. When it comes to the scoring of a goal, the determining factor for a high stick is the height of the crossbar, as opposed to the normal height of the shoulders. When an attacking player causes the puck to enter the opponent's goal by contacting the puck above the height of the crossbar, either directly or deflected off any player, the goal shall be disallowed.
Deflected in, but it's not going to count.
In this example, Nikita Kucherov's stick is above the height of the crossbar when he tips the puck into the net. The goal is disallowed. If the puck makes contact with the stick at or below the level of the crossbar and enters the goal, this goal shall be allowed. Here, Sebastian Aho's stick is below the height of the crossbar when he bats the puck into the Canadien's net. The goal is allowed. Rule 81, icing. The center red line will divide the ice into halves. Should any player of a team shoot, bat, or deflect the puck from his own half of the ice beyond the goal line of the opposing team, play shall be stopped. There are two judgments required for icing the puck. The linesman must first determine that the puck will cross the goal line. Once the linesman determines that the puck will cross the goal line, icing is completed upon the determination as to which player, attacking or defending, would touch the puck first. This decision by the linesman will be made no later than the instant the first player reaches the end zone face-off dots, with the player's skate being the determining factor. In this example, the Blue Jackets player shoots the puck into the Maple Leafs' end. At the face-off dots, the linesman judges the Maple Leafs player will touch the puck first. Icing is called. Here, the Hurricanes player shoots the puck into the Penguins' end. At the face-off dots, the linesman judges the Penguin player will touch the puck first. Icing is called. It should be noted, although the Penguin player reaches out with his stick, the player's skate is the determining factor as to when the player reaches the face-off dot. If the race for the puck is too close to determine by the time the first player reaches the end zone face-off dots, icing shall be called. In this example, a puck is shot into the Penguin's end. The Penguin's player and the Maple Leafs player are beside one another as they reach the face-off dots. This race is too close. Icing is called. Should the puck be shot down the ice in such a manner that it travels around the boards and or back towards the end zone face-off dots, the same procedure shall be in effect in that the linesman shall determine within a similar distance as to who will have touched the puck first.
Icing is waved off thanks to the hustle of Brandon Peary.
As a reminder, the determining factor is which player would first touch the puck, not which player would first reach the end zone face-off dots. In this example, a puck is shot into the wild end and wraps around the boards. Two wild players reach the faceoff dots first, but the linesman judges the Stars player would touch the puck first. Icing is waved off. In this example, a puck shot into the Jets' end bounces off the boards back toward the end zone faceoff dots. The linesman must take the distance traveled off the boards into consideration and make his decision before the faceoff dots as to who would have touched the puck first. The linesman judges the Jets player would touch the puck first. Icing is called. If, in the opinion of the linesman, the goalkeeper feigns playing the puck, attempts to play the puck, or skates in the direction of the puck on an icing at any time, the potential icing shall not be called and play shall continue. In this example, a puck is shot into the wild zone. Alex Stalock feigns playing the puck, therefore, icing is waved off. If, however, a goalkeeper is legitimately out of the crease in an attempt to go to the player's bench to be substituted for an extra attacker and in no way makes an attempt to play the puck, the icing should not be nullified under this section. In this example, Cam Talbot is on his way to the Flames bench when the Stars ice the puck. He makes no attempt to play the puck. Icing is called. If, in the opinion of the linesman, any player of the opposing team is able to play the puck before it passes his goal line, but has not done so, play shall continue, and the icing violation shall not be called.
Yeah, I think White Cloud Mary had a chance to play it, but linesman saw it, read it, made the right call.
In this example, a wild player passes the puck from his own side of the red line. A Sabres player lifts the stick of the wild player attempting to play the puck. The linesman judges the Sabre player could have played the puck. Icing is waved off. If the puck touches any part of a player of the opposing side, including his skates or his stick, at any time before crossing the goal line, it shall not be considered icing. In this example, the Hurricanes player shoots the puck from his side of center, but it is deflected by the Capitals player before going into the Capitals zone. Icing is waved off. We hope this video has given you a better understanding of Rule 81, icing. Beginning in the 2020-21 season, a player's skate will not have to be in contact with the blue line in order to be onside. A player is onside when either of his skates are in contact with the blue line or on his own side of the line at the instant the puck completely crosses the leading edge of the blue line. on his own side of the line shall be defined by a plane of the blue line, which shall extend from the leading edge of the blue line upwards. If a player's skate has yet to break the plane prior to the puck crossing the leading edge, he is deemed to be onside for the purpose of the offside rule. In this example, Eric Howla's back skate is in the air when the puck completely crosses the leading edge of the blue line. Previously, this play would be offside, but beginning in 2021, this play will be onside. Using the plane, it can be judged that Howla's back skate, while off the ice, is still on his own side of the line. In this example, Bobby Ryan's left skate is in the air when the puck completely crosses the blue line. Using the plane, it can be judged that Ryan's back skate, while off the ice, is still on his own side of the line. This interpretation, however, will not apply to a delayed offside. If an offside is delayed, players from the offending team must clear the zone, or tag up, with their skate in contact with the blue line. In this example, the Flames shoot the puck into the wild zone. A delayed offside is signaled. The offside player clears the zone by contacting the blue line with their skate. The Flames can re-enter the zone. In this example, the Lightning shoot the puck into the Bruins zone. A delayed offside is signaled. Braden Point clears the zone by contacting the blue line with his skate. At the same time, Barclay Goodrow is entering the zone. Using the plane, it can be judged that Goodrow's back skate, while off the ice, is still on his own side of the line. Previously, this play would be offside, but beginning in 2021, this play will be onside. Delayed offside. If an offside is delayed, the delay can be nullified if all offside players tag up or clear the zone, or the defending team passes or carries the puck into the neutral zone. It is important to note, when an offside player clears the zone or tags up, the puck may re-enter the offensive zone while the tagging up player is still in the attacking zone, as long as it isn't touched by an offensive player.
He's offside when it first comes, and then he swings his skates out over the blue line. He puts himself back onside right there as he comes back into the zone.
The play is onside. Offside. Possession and control. A player controlling the puck can cross the line ahead of the puck, provided he had possession and control of the puck prior to his skates crossing the blue line. It should be noted that while the offside rule is black and white, the element of possession and control is a judgment made by a linesman. In this example, Matt Duchene enters the attacking zone ahead of the puck, but is judged to have possession and control prior to his skates crossing the blue line. Duchene is onside. Penalty shot. A penalty shot shall be awarded when a player in the neutral or attacking zone is tripped or otherwise fouled from behind, thus preventing a reasonable scoring opportunity. The intention of this rule is to restore a reasonable scoring opportunity which has been lost.
Will they give it a penalty shot? Yes, they will.
In order for a penalty shot to be awarded, the following four criteria must have been met. 1. The infraction must have taken place in the neutral or attacking zone. In this example, Ivan Provorov trips Mike Hoffman, preventing a potential breakaway. The referee judges this infraction takes place in Hoffman's defensive zone, not the neutral or attacking zone. Therefore, no penalty shot is awarded, only a minor penalty for tripping. 2. The infraction must have been committed from behind. In this example, Anthony Mantha is driving the net when he is tripped. The referee judges this infraction has not been committed from behind, and therefore, a penalty shot is not awarded.
He's not fouled from behind, he's fouled from the side.
3. The player fouled must have been denied a reasonable chance to score. The fact that the player got a shot off does not automatically eliminate this play from the penalty shot consideration criteria. If the foul was from behind and the player was denied a more reasonable scoring opportunity due to the foul, then the penalty shot should still be awarded. In this example, Casey Mittelstadt is hooked on a breakaway.
Short-handed walks in. Penalty will be called.
The referee judges Mittelstadt was not denied a reasonable chance to score. Therefore, no penalty shot is awarded. 4. The player fouled must have had no opposing player between himself and the goalkeeper. In this example, Nathan MacKinnon is hooked on his way to the net.
MacKinnon, he made the breakaway and shoots wide of the net. Penalty's coming up on the flames.
The referee judges that there is an opposing player between MacKinnon and the goalkeeper, and therefore a penalty shot is not awarded. In this example, Brett Connolly is tripped on a breakaway by William Carrier.
Brett Connolly is tripped!
Will they give it a penalty shot? Yes, they will.
The infraction occurs in the attacking zone. Connolly is fouled from behind. While he gets a shot off, the referee judges Connolly is denied a more reasonable scoring opportunity, and there is no player between Connolly and the goalkeeper. All the criteria are met, and Connolly is awarded a penalty shot. Video review. Puck crossing the goal line. A goal shall be scored when the puck is put between the goalposts, entirely across the red line, with the goal frame in its proper position. In this example, Zach Sanford's wraparound appears to be stopped by Peter Mrazek before play is stopped.
And Darren, I can't tell from this angle if it went in, but it was close.
After video review, it is determined that the puck did cross the goal line, and a goal is awarded. Here, Connor Hellebuck appears to make a glove save on Dominic Simon.
And Hellebuck might have been across the line, Mirzy, I don't know.
After video review, it is determined that the puck, while in Hellebuck's glove, crossed the goal line. Pittsburgh is awarded a goal. When the situation room observes a goal that went undetected by the on-ice officials, the situation room shall instruct that the in-arena horn be sounded to stop play and to put play under video review.
They blow the horn, and that means one thing. They are going to review this, and if they've stopped play, they determine that this is a goal.
In this example, Tyler Grajovac's shot appears to go off the post and behind Mike Smith. As play continues, the situation room instructs the horn to be sounded to stop play. After video review, it is determined that the puck did cross the goal line, and a goal is awarded. Once the goal is awarded, the clock will be reset to the time the goal was scored. Video review. Puck in the net prior to the goal frame being dislodged. A goal shall be scored when the puck is put between the goalposts entirely across the goal line, with the goal frame in its proper position. In this example, Jamie Benn puts the puck in the net prior to it being dislodged. This is a good goal for Dallas. The goal frame shall be considered in its proper position when at least a portion of the flexible pegs are still inside both the goalpost and the hole in the ice. The flexible pegs could be bent, but as long as at least a portion of the flexible pegs are still in the hole in the ice and the goalpost, the goal frame shall be deemed to be in its proper position. In this example, Tyler Seguin's shot beats Jacob Markstrom as the net is lifted off the ice. After review, it is determined a portion of the peg is still inside both the goalpost and the hole in the ice. This is a good goal for Dallas. Although a goal can be scored with the post off the ice, the puck must enter the net in a proper manner between the posts and not through the netting or underneath the goal frame. In this example, Braden Holtby's net is lifted off the ice, but the pegs are still inside the goal and the hole in the ice.
There, see the net? See the net, how it's up? And it goes under.
Chris Kunitz pokes the puck into the net, but underneath the goal frame. This is no goal. Keep in mind, a goal can be scored with the net dislodged. In order to award a goal in this situation, the goalpost must have been displaced by the actions of a defending player.
Score! They're going to count it, even though the net was off the mooring.
The attacking player must have an imminent scoring opportunity prior to the goalpost being displaced, and it must be determined that the puck would have entered the net between the normal position of the goalposts. In this example, Anders Nielsen accidentally displaces his post when TJ Oshie puts the puck into the net. Oshie has an imminent scoring opportunity prior to the goalpost being displaced. Therefore, a goal is awarded to Washington. video review. Puck struck with a high stick. When an attacking player causes the puck to enter the opponent's goal by contacting the puck above the height of the crossbar, either directly or deflected off any player or official, the goal shall be disallowed.
Deflected in, but it's not going to count.
The determining factor for high stick video review is where the puck makes contact with the stick in relation to the crossbar. This is unlike a normal high-sticked puck, Rule 80, in which the determining factor for a high stick is the normal height of the shoulders. If the puck makes contact with a portion of the stick that is at or below the level of the crossbar and enters the goal shall be allowed. In this example, Zemgus Gergensens deflects the puck below the level of the crossbar and into the Vancouver net. The goal is allowed. If the puck makes contact with the stick above the level of the crossbar, the goal shall be disallowed.
No goal is the call.
And the referee right away ruled high stick.
In this example, Jonas Donskoy bats the puck out of midair and into the net. The puck makes contact with Donskoy's stick over the height of the crossbar. The goal is disallowed. Video review. Distinct kicking motion. Plays that involve a puck entering the net as a direct result of a distinct kicking motion shall be ruled no goal. A distinct kicking motion, for purposes of video review, is one where the video makes clear that an attacking player has deliberately propelled the puck with a kick of his foot or skate, and the puck subsequently enters the net.
No goal this time.
In this example, Brendan Gallagher uses a distinct kicking motion to propel the puck into the Senators' net. The goal is disallowed. A goal cannot be scored on a play where an attacking player propels the puck with his skate into the net, even by means of a subsequent deflection off of another player, using a distinct kicking motion.
And it looks like he flicks out his left foot.
In this example, Oliver Bjorkstrand uses a distinct kicking motion to propel the puck. It subsequently deflects off Ivan Provorov and into the Flyers' net. The goal is disallowed. A puck that deflects into the net off an attacking player's skate who does not use a distinct kicking motion shall be ruled a goal. In this example, Sam Steele's centering pass goes off the skate of Adam Henrique and into the Predators' net. There is no distinct kicking motion. The goal is allowed. A puck that is directed into the net by an attacking player's skate shall also be ruled a goal, as long as no distinct kicking motion is evident.
It looked like it went off his right skate.
Might have been off his skate, right? But not a kicking motion.
In this example, Danton Heinen directs the pass from Brad Marchand into the Kings' net. This is not considered a distinct kicking motion. The goal is allowed. Video review. Puck batted in. If an attacking player has the puck deflected into the net, off his skate or body, in any manner, the goal shall be allowed. In this example, the puck deflects off Thomas Nosek's body before going into the net. The goal is allowed. Goals will be disallowed when the puck has been directed, batted, or thrown into the net by an attacking player by any means other than with a stick.
Werenski knocked it in with his right hand.
In this example, Zach Werenski attempts to play the puck with his hand, but ends up directing or batting it into the net. This goal is disallowed.
Chabot has brought it into the Tampa end. Anderson, he's on the bench. Oh, that was a great chance. And it's knocked into the net.
And they're saying no goal.
In this unique example, Colin White directs the puck into the net using his head.
Immediately, right away, the official waves it off. That's not a legal play.
This goal is also disallowed. Video review. Continuous play. A goal may be awarded after video review if the puck entered the net as the culmination of a continuous play where the result of the original shot was unaffected by any whistle blown by the referee upon losing sight of the puck. In this example, Colton Sisson's shot appears to be stopped by Jacob Markstrom when the referee blows his whistle. Puck continues, going through Markstrom's legs and into the net after the whistle sounds. This is a culmination of a continuous play where the result of the play was unaffected by the whistle. After review, the goal is allowed. In this example, however, Jonathan Quick makes a save, but the puck is loose between his legs.
And Quick held it long enough for the whistle, and the puck went in well after the whistle.
After the referee blows his whistle, Sam Reinhart pokes the puck into the net. The puck did not enter the net as the culmination of a continuous play. This goal is disallowed. Video review, penalty shot, shootout. Video review may be used for the legitimacy of all potential goals on penalty shot or shootout attempts to ensure compliance with applicable rules. Some examples include rebound goals or double taps, goalkeeper throwing stick, goalkeeper dislodging goal, shooter cradling puck above the normal height of the shoulders, shooter performing illegal spinorama move, shooter's continued forward advancement of puck. In this example, Dan Boyle appears to score in a shootout on Marc-Andre Fleury.
He scores, the Rangers win.
After video review, it is determined the puck hit the post and is put into the net on a rebound.
Watch this, one, and he hit it in again. It should be no goal. You gotta take that back.
The goal is disallowed. In this example, Alexander Georgiev throws his stick at Alex Ovechkin during a shootout attempt.
Well, that's a goal. And he threw a stick at him.
They're going to talk about it. Good point, Eddie.
After video review, a goal is awarded to the Capitals. In this example, Mitch Marner pulls the puck back, deking Mike Condon to score. After video review, it is determined the puck is being kept in motion toward the opponent's goal line. The goal is allowed. Of course, video review can also be used during a penalty shot or shootout for determining if the puck crossed the goal line.
It's in. That's not the underside of the bar, that's the underside of the net it hits.
Video review, major/match penalties. Referees shall review all plays that result in the assessment of a major or match penalty for the purpose of confirming or modifying their original call.
And remember, the officials can review any major penalty. It could be reduced to a minor, let's see.
After reviewing the play, the call is confirmed. We have 500 major for boarding.
The only major penalty this does not apply to is a fighting major. Following a review of a major or match penalty, the referee can either confirm his original call or reduce his original call to a minor penalty.
After video review, the call on the ice, we have a minor penalty for elbowing. 2 minutes.
Correct, Randy. They do reduce it to 2 minutes.
A referee cannot, however, reduce his original call to no penalty. Video review is only used to review a penalty that is called. video review is not used to add a penalty. Video review is also not used to increase a penalty, for example, from a minor to a major. Video review, double minor, high sticking. Referees shall have the option, but not the obligation, to review any double minor penalty for high sticking.
And I believe we got a penalty coming up to Jacob Larson here at the side of the net. He caught Yarncroke with a high stick.
Following a review, the double minor penalty can be confirmed or rescinded in the case where the stick causing the apparent injury was not the stick of the player being penalized.
Here's the non-penalty. It was the stick of Smith that high-sticked and cut Callie Yarncroke.
A double minor penalty for high-sticking cannot, however, be reduced to a minor penalty. Video review is only used to review a penalty that is called. Video review is not used to add a penalty. Video review is also not used to increase a penalty, for example, from a minor to a major.